Wow, what a time of worship, and I love that reminder. We can praise Him with a shout. We can praise Him with a whisper. We can praise Him with outstretched arms. We can praise Him down on our knees. And it's good to be in the house of the Lord. We welcome all of our campuses to this service, and we're just excited for what it is that God is doing. Now, I got to be here for a few days this week. My wife and I, we flew in real early Wednesday because there's a staff development day for the entire staff. And let me tell you, they had great worship. They had workshops that you could pick, and you could go to different ones and just see how it is that you could deepen in your walk with Christ. But then after that, they had a scavenger hunt. I learned a whole lot about this church through that scavenger hunt, all right? You know, they seem like very Christ-like, easygoing people, but you pack about 10 people in a car, and you say you're competing against another campus, and crazy things happen, right? And one of the things they had to do on the scavenger hunt, you had to find a fortune cookie that had the word happiness in the fortune, all right? And so there was one group, the communications department, they looked through 36 different ones and still had not found the word happiness, so they bought an entire case of fortune cookies. Rolling Meadows, you had to get a picture with a mannequin, so you had to stand in a storefront like you were a mannequin, and Rolling Meadows paid off the owner to let them do that. The Elgin campus has Sergio Velasquez, who evidently is an incredible go-kart driver, and he was actually hired out by other teams in order to drive for them. And so Sergio, here at Elgin, I have seen you on 90 East before, all right? Now, I need to share with you another part of the competition was they had escape rooms. How many of you are familiar with an escape room, what that is? You get in, you have to solve all sorts of clues, and, I mean, you're in there for a while until you finally figure things out. The Elgin campus did incredibly well, and they got out in record time. The only reason I'm sharing the story is because that was on Wednesday. Crystal Lake, your staff may still be in there, okay? No one ever saw them get out, and so be praying for that campus this morning, all right? But Thursday night, an incredible worship night. We just had a great worship night with all the campuses coming together. Friday and Saturday, there was a leadership retreat with the church leadership team, the campus pastors, and with the elders. And let me just say that God showed up in a really big way. And so for those of you who were praying for that, your prayers were answered, and it was a great time together. All that to say, I hope you realize how you are blessed with an incredible staff of a lot of super servants and some great leaders. Today we're continuing our study called Unsung, where we're taking a look at everyday people who have an uncommon faith. And this week we're going to take a look at a story that you've heard before, but it's a message on the faith of an unnamed person in the Bible. And my hope is that you will come to realize this: an uncommon faith believes even when it doesn't make sense. An uncommon faith believes even when it doesn't make sense. If you'll take your Bible out and turn to Matthew chapter 21, and while we've been looking at posture, let's all stand up today, and as we read God's word, I'm going to read this passage, Matthew 21, 1 through 11. You listen as I read. I'm going to have you join in at the end. Now, when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethphage, to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them at once." This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Say to the daughter of Zion, 'Behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. And the disciples went and they did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" Now I'm going to have you all join with me and read verses 10 and 11, and we're going to put it on the screen for you. "And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, saying, 'Who is this?' And the crowd said, 'This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee.'" May the Lord bless the reading of his word. You can be seated. So what I want us to do today is I want us to look at this story through the lens of faith. And we're going to divide this into three different sections. Here's section number one, the expressions of faith by the disciples. Look again at the opening verses of the passage, verses 1 and 2. "Now when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethphage to the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, 'Go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me.'" So that's the starting point. Mark's gospel adds the fact that the colt had not yet been broken. In other words, no one had ever gone for a ride on this colt. That's rather significant. Matthew tells us that it is a mother with her colt. So the disciples join in and they display uncommon faith, first of all, in everyday situations. You see, the disciples aren't asked to do anything incredible or supernatural. What made this event significant was the fact that they hadn't gone past this area, that Jesus had not seen this donkey. This is Jesus showing his divine foreknowledge. They had all been together. He had not been near Jerusalem, and yet he knows exactly where they will find this donkey. We spend most of our lives thinking that God is going to ask us for some really big things. He's going to ask us to take some huge risks for him. He's going to have me, when I'm 40 years old, leave my job and become a missionary over in Africa. Well, maybe. But usually what he asks for is our ongoing faithfulness in the everyday matters of life. And instead of asking these two disciples to be willing to die for him, Jesus simply says, "See the donkey? See the little donkey, untie them and bring them to me." It's not complicated. It just demands obedience. As strange as it sounds, really what it needs is it just requires follow through. So an uncommon faith is one that we should have in everyday situations, but we also can display that in unusual settings. I mean, this is an unusual request. And Matthew gives us a little bit more detail. You may have thought that there was only one donkey in this story, but there are actually two. There's the mother and there's the colt that he rides on. Now, you, like those disciples, are probably thinking, what an unusual request. Well, sometimes I think the Lord impresses some unique or seemingly bizarre demand of us just to see if we will trust him. Just to see if we're listening to him and we'll obey him. And maybe he takes you out of your comfort zone and he prompts you to strike up that conversation with that homeless man, or to do something anonymously for someone in need, or to reach out to someone who you have been at odds with for months. He just wants to see if you will be responsive. Do you have the faith to obey him? These disciples had a front row seat to seeing all sorts of different things through the life of Christ. And so they had plenty of reasons to obey him. It really didn't matter how unusual the request was. Regardless of its nature, they were going to obey him. Do you have that uncommon faith like these two disciples? Regardless of how unusual the expectation or the request of the Lord, as crazy as it might seem, do you still obey? Fill this in on your note page. Your responsiveness to his request reveals the level of his lordship in your life. How you respond, your willingness to obey and respond, reveals whether or not he really is the Lord and Master of your life. I mean, if you really are his servant, then you will do what it is that he says. And so Jesus says, as you go into this town, you're going to see a donkey and her colt. Just untie them and bring them to me. Look back at our text in Matthew 21. Look at verses 3 through 6 again. If anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord needs them, and he will send them at once. This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. Well, the disciples went, and they did as Jesus had directed them. Sometimes we learn things from God's word, from what's said. Other times we learn things from what's not said or isn't written. And this is a good example of that. Because evidently, there were no snags in the plan. There was nothing that went awry in the process. And the owner of the donkeys immediately complied with this unusual request when he heard that the Lord had a part in it. Now let's change gears and let's look at the second area. And that's the expressions of faith by the donkey owner. We just read that the disciples went and did just as Jesus had directed them. Now, we think of a donkey in a certain way. It's important for us to understand how a donkey or a colt would have been viewed back in that culture. They were a respected animal. They were very practical. They were used a lot in that agrarian setting. But they could also be obstinate, and they could also be stubborn. My wife is here. We've been married for almost 34 years. Our first argument that we ever had in married life was on our honeymoon, all right? And we made it 6 days. I'm kind of proud of that, actually. 6 days into the honeymoon before we really had a serious disagreement. And as usually is the case, it's over something that's not significant, right? Aren't you always a little bit embarrassed when somebody says, well, oh, what was the fight about? Well, and you tell them, they're like, really? You know what our discussion was about? I was trying to surprise her on the sixth night of the honeymoon with where I took her, and she guessed where we were going. And that hacked me off, right? there's no good reason why it did. It's just the fact that I was trying to surprise her, and she figured it out, and that made me mad. And she's like, why are you mad? So, you know, we're in counseling now. But we drove for about 45 minutes in silence, just not saying a word to each other. We're going through the rolling hills of Kentucky. We go past a farm at about the 45-minute mark. I glance over. In the corner of this farm, right up next to a fence, there is a donkey. I look at the donkey. I look back at my wife. I said, relative of yours? Yes. She said, yes, by marriage. Oh, don't clap, ladies. Come on. I know female applause when I hear it, all right? Yeah, now, good. Now you're going to clap louder. My wife will be greeting people in the lobby afterwards, okay? Look at the first expression of faith by the donkey owner. Here's number one. He trusted people who spoke on Christ's behalf. He trusted people who spoke on Christ's behalf. If questioned, the instructions the disciples were given were to say, the Lord needs them. And the man was content with that explanation, and he trusted people who spoke on Christ's behalf. It may have been all that he had with those donkeys. Maybe that's all he had. That might be all that he owned to his name, but he still trusted. Evidently, God had already touched the heart of this random donkey owner guy and told him, my son needs to use your donkey. That's crazy even to think about. But then again, that's how it is with all of us. He wants to use your talents. He wants to use your treasure. He wants to use your time. He wants to use your testimony. God can do stuff without us, and yet he chooses to work through us. and involve us in the process. Here's the second area. He released his possession to the Lord. We don't know how skeptical he was or how comfortable he was with doing this, but one thing is for sure, he released what was his into the hands of the Lord. And that is a mark of an uncommon faith. When you release to the Lord what you've saved, what you've earned, what you've received, what you've made, what you have accumulated. But we have a really hard time in our American culture of letting go, because we work so hard to accumulate that we have a very hard time with relinquishing what we have and releasing it. In fact, it just goes against the grain. Even though the Bible talks about it all the way through it, the importance of generosity, we just have a hard time letting go. Back in 1987, there was a commuter flight from Portland, Maine to Boston, Massachusetts. The pilot heard an unusual noise near the rear of the plane, and Henry Dempsey turned the controls over to the co-pilot, and Dempsey went back to check things out. When he reached the tail section, the plane hit an air pocket, and Dempsey was tossed against the rear door. He quickly discovered that the original noise was caused because the rear door had not been latched properly before takeoff. And so now the impact of his weight caused the door to open, and Dempsey was instantly sucked out of the tiny jet. The co-pilot saw the red light that indicated an open door. He radioed to the nearest airport requesting permission for an emergency landing. He also asked that for a helicopter to be brought and to begin searching that particular area for the co-pilot. But after the plane landed, the ground crew found Dempsey holding on to the outdoor ladder of the aircraft. So evidently what happened was, when the door opened, somehow he had the wherewithal just to reach out, and he grabbed a rung on the ladder. And so what he did was he held on for dear life, and the plane was flying at 200 miles per hour. It was at 4,000 feet altitude. And as it came all the way down with him holding on for dear life, it took 10 minutes for it to land. When the plane landed, he had 12 inches of leeway to keep his head from bouncing on the asphalt, and somehow he was able to do it. My favorite part of the story was that after Dempsey was discovered by the ground crew, they said that it took airport personnel several minutes to pry his hands away. I guess so, right? Mr. Dempsey, you can let go. I'm trying. Right? I have seen a lot of people hold on to money and possessions with that same white knuckle intensity. And they are more into keeping than giving. And they will hold on to their paycheck, and they will hold on to their possessions, and they will store and hoard far beyond what it is that is needed. And they will never release it. The Lord doesn't ask you for 50% of your money. The Lord doesn't ask you for 30% of your money. The Lord asks for 10%. He asks for a tithe. And many will try to hold on to it, even though it doesn't belong to them. And they will continue to hold on to it until something or someone comes along who captures their heart and allows them to release it. You see, when Christ becomes more important than what you have or your image or your possessions, when Christ becomes more important than that, that's when we release those things. Jesus wants you to experience the joy that comes through a generous life, a life that shares with others, a life that reaches out and cares for others, a life that is consumed with helping other people out and carrying out God's work. So when God asks for us to release what we have to him, we have to trust that he has a plan. He may be saying, Harvest, I want to unleash compassion locally and globally in a broken world and bring hope and light so that this entire region will hear your actions communicate this truth. You are loved. And since everything that we have actually belongs to our master, then it stands to reason that my spirit and your spirit ought to be, God, if you want to use my donkey, I'm in. Because it's really your donkey. It's his donkey anyway. And God expects you to share what he has entrusted to you, just like the donkey owner did. Here's a third expression of faith, and that is he watched how God used it for his glory. How did God use these two donkeys and this act of service and generosity? How did God use that for his glory? Well, the first way he used it was to force the hands of the religious leaders. You see, that's what's happening here. You have to understand, when Jesus comes riding on this colt, this was actually a traditional Jewish ceremony for royalty. Jesus is not on an ego trip. Instead, he is letting the world know that there's something significant that is happening, and it all revolves around his identity. And so Jesus is going to force the hand of his enemies. They were going to kill him after the Passover. But God had ordained from the foundation of the world that Jesus would be the Passover lamb who would take away the sins of the world. And so God's plan forced them to act sooner than they had planned to. Jesus said, "My hour has come." Look in your Bible at verses 7 through 10 of our text in Matthew chapter 21. It says in verse 7, "They brought the donkey and the colt and put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. Most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, 'Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.' And when he entered Jerusalem," get this, "the whole city was stirred up." The whole city was stirred. You see, when Jesus comes into our midst, he draws us to him. We can't look away. Here's the second way that God used this for his glory, and that was Jesus declaring his deity. He's letting the world know, this is who I am. When Jesus came into the city, this is a natural time when he should have been laying low. Everyone was out for him. Everyone was on the lookout for him. The religious leaders wanted him. They were waiting for that time. That would be the perfect time to kind of stay back in the shadows, to not come out in the middle of broad daylight. But not Jesus. Jesus boldly and publicly comes out. He chose the Passover week when tens of thousands of visitors would be streaming into the city. He arranged to arrive in such a way that it was unmistakable that he was claiming to be the Messiah. And that's the third way that we see God move, and that is he does this to fulfill an Old Testament prophecy. The entire nation knew that years before the prophet Zechariah had predicted in Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." So Jesus comes riding on the foal of a donkey. And if that owner knew anything about the Old Testament scriptures, then after Christ's resurrection, he had to be thinking, "I'm the most blessed guy in all the world. I can't believe that God gave me this privilege that hundreds of years ago, the donkey that was talked about was one of my donkeys. God prophesied about my donkeys." Do you have any idea how that guy would have felt? The psalmist said to God, "What is man that you are mindful of him?" We get to have a kingdom impact. Well, let's conclude by looking at some takeaways that we can have from this story. Here's takeaway number one. How strange that God asks us for anything. I mean, does that blow your mind? That God would ask finite, imperfect man for something? Jesus had the power to supernaturally take care of it himself. He didn't have to orchestrate this to happen. He didn't have to have anybody go get the donkeys. He could have made a donkey right there. He could have done whatever he wanted to supernaturally. But he chooses to invite us in and involve us in his story. And if you think about it, it's crazy to think that God borrowed a donkey from someone. He asked to borrow something that he had created. That's how he works. And throughout Christ's ministry, Jesus taught us that you are not an owner, that I am not an owner. The things that we think that we have, that we've accumulated, that we've acquired, we don't own those things. God has entrusted them to us. And we are the managers of those. We are the stewards of those. And my responsibility is to honor who the rightful owner is. 1 Chronicles chapter 29, verse 11. Everything in the heavens and on earth is yours, O Lord, and this is your kingdom. We adore you as the one who is over all things. So it all belongs to God. Whatever you have in your wallet, that's his. The house that you live in, God's. Your possessions, your savings, your investments. All of those different things, but belong to him. And we need to feel the tension of carrying and managing God's money. But secondly, he invites us in. Secondly, how absurd that Jesus rides into town on the generosity of ordinary people. Is that crazy? How absurd that Jesus rides into town on the generosity of just ordinary people. Jesus is going to declare his deity and he will borrow someone's animal to do it. That means that through our generosity as imperfect human beings, God is willing to use us to write his story. Maybe you heard about what happened to Hollis Sharp in the Los Angeles area not too long ago. Every night she would take her miniature poodle for a walk around the block, and she would make four block walk all around in a square. She was a very conscientious citizen, so what she would do is she would take a plastic bag with her, and if her dog made a mess in someone's yard, she would clean it up, and she would put the contents then inside of that bag. And one night she was out walking around, and she was with the dog, but she was also carrying a full bag. And a mugger came up, and he shoved her to the ground, and he grabbed the bag, and he ran off with the spoils of his crime. Of course, the police were called, and police said that she suffered a broken arm, but she maintained her sense of humor, and when asked about it, she said, "I only wish I would have had more for him in the bag." That's generosity. It's true generosity to want to give somebody more than what we really have, right? Now, it's absurd that Jesus rides into town on the generosity of ordinary people. Jesus could have come into town any way he wanted. Why did he come on a donkey? Why did he ride on this colt? Why not a Black Hawk helicopter? Why not Air Force One? Why didn't he have the angelic choir right there that scared the daylights out of the shepherds on the night that Jesus was born? It's simple. Because he wants you involved in the story. He wants to pull you into the story. He values ordinary people like you and me, so you don't have to be the richest person in town for God to use you. And even if you only have a donkey, or even a little donkey, don't ever think that God could never use you. Of course he can. In fact, he specializes in taking that which is ordinary and using it for extraordinary purposes. Here's the third takeaway I want you to see. How unusual that we get back what we give. We get back what we give. I envision that this donkey owner probably followed at a safe distance. You know, I mean, this was his livelihood. These were his donkeys. And I think that he probably just kind of stayed along from a safe distance, kind of like a hot air balloon. When the hot air balloon's up in the air and you see it somewhere out in the country and you're driving around, all of a sudden you see that there's a van that's just kind of following and trying to see where it's going to land, right? Just kind of staying close. I think that's kind of how it was for this guy. Just wants to make certain the colt doesn't get spooked. Oh, no, what's he doing? He's getting on that colt. Does he know that's never been ridden before? Oh, well, I guess he knows what he's doing, right? And he just is close by just to make certain that everything goes okay. He's protecting his assets. He wants to make certain that what he owns is in safe keeping. But here's what you have to catch. Whatever you give to the Lord, he's going to give back to you. And this man loans this out, but understand that he got the donkey back. Jesus didn't take the donkey as a souvenir. Jesus didn't say, you know what, I would love to have two donkeys for my final week before my crucifixion. I'd just like to hang out with these donkeys. I'm certain once he was done with them, he nodded at that man took them. Why is that significant? Whatever it is that you give to Jesus, Jesus is going to make certain that you're taken care of. I don't know what happened later in this man's life. I don't know what happened. I don't know if he put a painting over the top of his barn that said, this is where Jesus rode these donkeys. Maybe at a petting zoo and he charged people to come and pet the donkey that Jesus rode on. I don't know what happened. The story is not about the donkeys. The story is not about the donkey owner. The story is about the one who was riding on the donkey. And he is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and he shall reign forever and ever. And when Jesus Christ rode on that donkey into Jerusalem, he was saying, I am the Messiah whom you've been looking for, who you have waited for. This is significant. There were no issues for Jesus or for the colt. I'm certain that he entrusted these donkeys back to this unnamed man of faith who had said yes to this unusual request. God doesn't ask you to do what others do. God doesn't ask you to give what others give. He asks you to do your part with what he's entrusted to you. What do you have? You have $1 million? You have a four-legged farm animal? In God's economy, it really doesn't matter. He just wants you to be willing to release what he's entrusted to you. A donkey was an animal of peace. When you ride on a horse, your feet can never touch the ground. When you ride on a donkey, if you're tall, guess what? Your feet can touch the ground. Jesus rode low. Jesus was humble. Jesus was a man of peace. Louis Giglio says it like this. He says, if Jesus came in on a donkey, then maybe I should get off of my high horse. He wants sacrifice. He wants obedience. He wants us to understand lordship. Sacrifice is giving up something that you love for something that you love more. Let me give you a peek into my childhood and my family. When I was a kid, our family, we would travel about 2 hours away from Cincinnati over into Indiana to where my grandparents lived. My grandparents, they lived on a farm there. And my brother and I, we made so many great memories. We loved it the 3 or 4 times a year when we would get to go there. And I have so many special memories of running around that farm. But the thing that would really touch us was the last moment as we were leaving. Grandmother would come out of the house. My mom would crank that window down and roll it down. And grandmother would come out with a Tupperware filled with chocolate chip cookies that she had made. And she would reach into the car and she'd wink at my mom and she'd say, here's some cookies that I'd made. And my mom would say thanks and smile. We'd get down the road and we couldn't wait for her to open that Tupperware up. We said, oh, can we have some cookies? Can we have some cookies? And the same thing happened time and time again. She would reach back and we would dive in and take 2 or 3 cookies. But one time I noticed a pattern. I noticed something that was taking place. You know what she would do? Instead of my mom reaching for a cookie to eat, my mom would begin digging underneath the cookies. And there was an envelope. There was an envelope in the bottom of the Tupperware container. You see, every time we came, my grandmother would hide a $5 bill in an envelope under the cookies. Because all of grandmother's children were in the ministry, and they were barely making ends meet. And in the late 1960s, $5 covered the gasoline for our out-of-state trip. So she did it for them whenever they came, but she had to hide it because our granddad didn't like to share his resources with his family. My grandmother enjoyed giving. my granddad enjoyed keeping. Which grandparent do you think I wanted to be like? Purposeful, generous giving is always more attractive and useful than selfishness and greed. Grandmother released her donkeys and shared them. Granddad wasn't willing to untie his. Warren Wiersbe said, an open heart cannot maintain a closed hand. On your note page, I put down three questions that I hope you'll ponder today. Who is he asking you to trust? Who is he asking you to trust? And this story, this owner had to trust these people who spoke on behalf of God. Who do you need to trust? What is he asking you to release? And how does he want to reveal his glory? Probably you've all heard of the book, The Five Love Languages. Gary Chapman wrote it years ago. It's been a best-selling book year after year. It helps you relate to those who are close to you, maybe a spouse, maybe a boyfriend or girlfriend, maybe a best friend or a college roommate. And as you study, you discover that other person's best way to receive love and also that other person's best way to express love. And as I read through this text this week, it kind of got me to thinking, what are God's love languages? And this is what I came up with. The best way God receives love is through obedience. I mean, you shouldn't have much of an argument over that, since after all, in John 14, 15, Jesus says, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. So obedience is what God is looking for from us. Trust when it doesn't seem to make sense, an uncommon faith. But then I thought about the best way that God expresses love to us, and based on my own firsthand experience, this is what I came up with. The best way that God expresses love is through grace. It's through grace. And maybe some of you can relate to that because you've experienced it as well. And the truth be known, our actions have given us ample opportunities to become a recipient of grace. Can I point out the obvious of this story? The obvious thing that you know is they didn't crucify the donkeys. A few days later, they will crucify the Lamb of God. They will crucify Jesus. And why? Because the Lamb of God takes away the sin of the world. And he became a perfect sacrifice to pay for all the crud that I will ever do and all the mistakes that you will ever make. And he invites you to put your trust in him, to let go, to release your life, your possessions, who you are, what you can become, to release all of that to him. And that's what he cares about more than anything. He cares about you, and he wants you. Let's pray. Lord, this is our heartfelt prayer. Our prayer is, what do I have that's tied up? Lord, help me to untie it and let it go and bring it to Jesus. I'm covered by your blood, Lord. I'm known by you and loved. Help me to live a life that reflects the forgiveness that you have given to all those who have trusted in you. It's in the powerful name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.